Samuel, chapter 17. We're going to do a little David and Goliath this morning. How's that sound? Last week's sermon. Pastor Pam shared something very powerful. If you haven't listened to it or watched it, go do that right now. Okay, you can wait a minute. Just don't do it in this room. So, check it out. It was about our expectation being in who? In God. In God. That our expectation is not in humanity. We don't do what we do or not do because of people's responses. This key verse here that she shared with us, Psalm 62:5 from the King James Version, "My soul, wait thou only upon God, for my expectation is from Him." And she talked about how if we don't do what we're doing for God and because of God, we may find ourselves hardened or lacking the fuel to drive us to continue being the people we want to be. We've been talking about the last month, and then we've heard all this morning about being the light unto the world, being a blessing to our neighbors, loving our brothers and sisters, reaching those that don't know the Lord. And if we're doing it and they don't respond right, we get all weird about that sometimes, don't we? But if we are serving through the lens of we're doing what we're doing, we're living the way we're living because God is good, and He's the one I'm serving, and He's the one I'm pleasing. And my expectation is results and all that stuff. I'm not worried about other people. My expectation is in who? God. My expectation is in who? I'll tell you, neighbor, I don't know about you, but my expectation is in God. Amen. I love how y'all just talk over each other. You don't wait. You never wait for each other. It's like, tell your neighbor and say hi. You both say hi, and it just doesn't work out. If you don't have your expectation in God, you're going to stop doing that one day. So, the goal and where she brought us to was that we can be free to love because we are doing what we're doing for God and not just for who's in front of us and dependent on their responses or not. It's very important. And so, what I want to talk about today is what fuels our ability to actually do that. Great principle. True. I want that to be true about my life. But it's not always true about my life. How can it be true about my life? What can fuel my ability to love and serve unconditionally and not be about the other people? Well, how can that actually happen? How can I be rooted in my expectation being in God alone? And I want to start by sharing this great line from a rap song. It says this. Lecrae is a Grammy Award-winning rapper. He said, "If you live for people's acceptance, you'll die from their rejection." And that's what we're looking at here. Like, if we're living for other people and what their response is, and don't get me wrong, like, there's a part of the human relationship with other humans that we love acceptance. And it kind of like, it's like, oh, do that, say that again. That was nice. You said, what about the way I look today? Or, oh, you thought I blessed you in what way? I didn't hear you. Could you say it again? Right? And that's good. And we should compliment each other. We should encourage each other. That's a big part of being a follower of Jesus. However, if you're living for people's acceptance, you will die from their rejection. And when they say no and they don't notice and they don't compliment and they don't love back, or even worse, they hate back, it just kills you. So how can that not be true about us? That's what we're going to look at this morning. And of course, we're going to David and Goliath to show that, right? That's what you thought we were going to do today. All right. Let's get the story. 1 Samuel 17, verse 1. If you don't have a Bible, get near someone who does. We're going to read some scriptures this morning. "Now the Philistines gathered their armies for battle, and they were gathered together at Socah, which belongs to Judah, and they camped between Socah and Azekah in Ephesh Dami." This is 1 Samuel 17, now verse 2. "Saul, who was the king of everyone, and the men of Israel were gathered and camped in the valley of Elah, and they drew up in battle array to encounter the Philistines." The Philistines are the arch enemy of Israel and the people of God. And so the Philistines stood on the mountain on one side, while Israel stood on the mountain on the other side, with the valley in between them. And then a champion came out from the armies of the Philistines named Goliath from Gath, that's a city in the Philistine region, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. That's
at least 9 feet 9 inches. 9 feet 9 inches. Most ceilings are 10 feet. A top of a basketball rim is 10 feet. He was, with his hair, like he had big hair, it hit the rim. You kind of picture Goliath not really cleaned up, right? He doesn't have like a good looking cut. He's got the mangly do. So he's hitting the rim. He's 9 foot 9 inches. He had a bronze helmet on his head that covered that mane, and he was clothed with scale armor, which weighed 5,000 shekels of bronze. So his armor was 125 pounds. Some of y'all weigh 125 pounds. He's wearing that on us, on him, as his armor. He also had bronze greaves on his legs and bronze javelin slung between his shoulders. His shaft was a spear like a weaver's beam, and the head of his spear weighed 600 shekels. Just the head was 15 pounds, and his shield carrier walked before him. He stood and he shouted to the ranks of Israel and said to them, "Why do you come out drawn up in battle array? Am I not the Philistine and you the servants of Saul? Choose a man for yourselves and let him come down to me. If he is able to fight with me and kill me, then we will become your servants. But if I prevail against and kill him, then you shall become our servants and do what?" Again the Philistine said, "I defy the ranks of Israel this day. Give me a man that we may fight together." Saul and all Israel heard these words of the Philistine. They were dismayed and greatly afraid. Now David was the son of the Ephraite of Bethlehem in Judah, whose name was Jesse. And Jesse had 8 sons. And Jesse was old in the days of Saul, advanced in the years among men. And 3 older sons of Jesse had gone after Saul to battle. And the names of his 3 sons who went to battle were Eliab the firstborn, the second's name Abinadab, and the third, Shammah. David was the what? He's the youngest of 8 sons, and the 3 oldest followed Saul. But David went back and forth from Saul to tend to his father's flock of sheep at Bethlehem. The Philistine came forward morning and evening for 40 days and took his stand. 40 days he came out and took his stand. Then Jesse said to David his son, "Take now for your brothers an ephah of this roasted grain and these 10 loaves and run to the camp of your brothers. Bring also 10 cups of cheese to the commander of their 1,000, and they took, and then look into the welfare of your brothers and bring back news of them. For Saul and they and all the men of Israel are in the valley of Elah fighting with the Philistines." So David arose early in the morning, left his flock with a keeper, and took the supplies and went as Jesse had commanded him. And he came to the circle of the camp where the army was going out in battle array, shouting the war cry. Israel and the Philistines drew up in battle array, army against army. And David left his baggage in the care of the baggage keeper and ran to the battle line to enter and entered in order to greet his brothers. And as he was talking with them, behold, the champion, the Philistine from Gath, what's his name again? Goliath, was coming up in the army of the Philistines and spoke these same words, and this time David heard them. When all the men of Israel saw the man, they fled from him and were greatly afraid. Now, these aren't like the wet noodles of Israel. These are the soldiers of the army. King Saul, who was a warrior and bigger and taller than everybody else, and all these soldiers, right? This wasn't just like the children's fellowship. These were soldiers. These were men's men. And Goliath leaves them greatly afraid. Verse 25. The men of Israel said, "Have you seen this man who's coming? Surely he's coming up to defy Israel, and it will be that the king will enrich the man who kills him with great riches, and will give him his daughter and make him famous, or make his father's house free in Israel." Verse 26. Then David spoke to the men who were standing by him, saying, "What will be done for the man who kills this Philistine and takes away the reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should taunt the armies of the living God?" And the people answered him in accord with this word, saying, "Thus it will be done for the man who kills him," and tell him what the reward would be. Verse 28, Eliab, David's older brother, heard when he spoke to the men. And Eliab's anger burned against David. And he said, "Why have you come down? And with whom have you left those few sheep in the wilderness? I know your insolence and the wickedness of your heart, for you've come down in order to see the battle." But David said, "What have I done now?" Can't you see him, like your little brother saying that? Like, "What did I do? I'm just asking a question." Men, He turned away from him to another and said the same thing. And the people answered the same thing as before. Now, verse 31, when the words which David spoke were heard, they told them to Saul, and he sent for him. You see, nobody else was talking like David was amongst the men, and so the word gets to Saul. David said to Saul, let no man's heart fail on account of him, for your servant will go and fight with this Philistine. And Saul said to David, you're not able to go to this Philistine to fight with him, for you're but a youth. He's been a warrior from his youth. But David said to Saul, your servant was tending your father's sheep, and when a lion or a bear came and took the lamb from the flock, I went after him and attacked him and rescued it from his mouth. And when he rose up against me, I seized him by his beard and I struck him and I killed him. And your servant has killed both the lion and the bear. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, since he has taunted the armies of the living God. Verse 37, and David said, the Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of the Philistine. And Saul said to David, go, and may the Lord be with you. We're almost done. Verse 38, then Saul clothed David with his garments and put a bronze helmet on his head, and he clothed him with armor. David girded his sword over his armor and tried to walk, for he had not tested them. Again, Saul was a lot bigger than David was. David was just a young man. So David said to Saul, I cannot go with these, for I have not tested them. And David took them off. In verse 40, he took his stick in his hand and chose for himself five smooth stones from the brook and put them in the shepherd's bag which he had, even in his pouch, and his sling was in his hand, and he approached, who? The Philistine. So this is a great setup for what's about to happen, and I hope somebody in here doesn't know what happened. Your mind's going to be blown. But for most people, we know what's going to happen. But I wanted to bring this record to light in light of last week, in light of what Pastor Pam shared, to help us understand what fuels and where our lives and hearts need to be rooted in order for us to be like Lecrae said, not living for people's acceptance, but then we'll die from their rejection, but having our expectation be in God. And so as David is approaching the Philistine, as David is on his way to go serve God, and in this case it's to battle Goliath, he faces some resistance. And I'm not even talking about Goliath, the part of the resistance of Goliath. And you'll notice that the two things that he faces as far as resistance are very common things that we face in our pursuit of serving God. The first one was our family. You see what happens when David gets there, and who's the first person that he runs into? He runs into his family. He runs into Eliab, his older brother. And you know, one of the things that can really quench the work of God in your life and the growth of Christ being formed in you is your family, God bless you. And not just your family, but close relationships. Maybe your husband, your wife, your boyfriend, your girlfriend, you know. Family pressure is one of the things that can really be resistance against us serving God. Here's what I mean. Look at what happens with David. Back in verse 28. Eliab, his older brother, heard when he spoke to the men, and Eliab's anger burned against David, and he said, why have you come down? And with whom have you left those few sheep in the wilderness? You see, his brother mocks him in front of everybody else. He embarrasses him in front of the other men. Here's David. He's getting excited. He's come with a pure heart. He's passionate about the name of God and wants to stop this Philistine that's causing trouble and denouncing Yahweh. And his brother is like, dude, what are you doing here, right? You've been in those situations where, like, someone calls you out or says something in front of other people. Oh, man, that can really crush you, can it? If you care what these people think, and you do care what your family thinks and your loved one. And so the first thing that Eliab does is he mocks him in front of other people, and there's an opportunity for embarrassment. And then what he says is, look at this, he says, with whom have you left, what? Those few sheep in the wilderness. Isn't this a brother? Isn't this just a sibling? He doesn't say, like, where are the sheep that are under your care? He says, where did you leave those few sheep that you little boy are back home taking care of for daddy? Where's the cheese and crackers you brought? Just go back home with a few sheep. So he reminds David of his weakness and his position. And then lastly, he reminds him of the opportunity of failure, right? He says that at the end, I know your insolence and the wickedness of your heart, for you've come down here in order to see the battle. Sometimes it's your family and the people closest to you that know the mistakes you've made in the past, right? And they know maybe your motives before Christ or how you've messed up in the past, and sometimes they know just when to bring that up in a loving way, right? Like, what are you doing here? Are you just here to, like, watch the battle? Because I know back home, you just play video games all day, and you just care for a few sheep, and you're bringing daddy's Lunchables for us. That's some resistance. That's your brother. That's your older brother in front of soldiers, in front of army. When you're coming with a pure heart and vulnerable, he mocks you, he embarrasses you in front of people, he reminds you of your position, and reminds you of your failures, and calls into question your motive. And then the second kind of resistance that David faces is in front of an authority figure, like Saul. Verse 33, let's look at that again. This is the king of the nation and the general of the army. Saul said to David, you are not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for you are but a youth, while he has been a warrior from his youth. Now, besides like family and close relationship pressure that can try to quench our desire to serve God, pressure from those in positions of authority or influence can be that too. So here he's standing before the king, the pure-hearted young man coming to care about what God cares about. He comes into the king, right, because he's been promoted there by all the guys saying, this guy, and Saul's like, let me hear what you have to say, son. He tells him, I'm ready to fight Goliath. Remember 9'9" Goliath? I'm ready to fight Goliath. And Saul just flat out dismisses him. You can't do that. So the one that probably is the one that gets to commission him to actually do it, he has authority over David in this position. David's not just going to run out and do it himself. He's under the authority of Saul. Saul says, you can't do that. You're not up to it. The Hebrew says, you don't have the power. And also, not only does he declare the failure, but he reminds him about his limitations. You are but a youth. Anybody ever, like, talk about your limitations to you? I mean, that can either destroy you or enrage you. Especially someone that has authority, like your boss or a church leader or your parents or something like that. You know, and they say, well, you couldn't do that. You know, I need some help later on after church, Rachel. No, Lorraine, I don't need your help. I'm all set. Rachel, I can really use your help because you're just great at that. And Lorraine said, no. I should stay home one moment and watch the webcast. So Saul puts his limitations before him here, but he also elevates his opposition and the challenge. You couldn't do that because you're a youth. Goliath has been a warrior since his youth. You're eight, however old you are, David, you're 13. He already was a warrior at your age, and you're just a kid bringing a sack lunch for daddy. So these two incidents, the family pressure and the authority figure, represent where many of us can get tripped up. I know I struggle with these. In our close relationships, friends, family, spouse, an authority figure, boss, teacher, parent, church leader. Close relationships, because of love, intimacy, and vulnerability that exists, and the authority figure because of their influence and their power to reward or punish, promote or demote. And so it's crazy to think about this. I know this is crazy. Like, I'm admitting to you how often I struggle with this, and it's crazy to say the following. We rise and fall in our relationship with God based on what they think, what they do, what they say, or what they don't do or don't say. I rise and fall with my ability to keep serving God or keep in mind my identity as a child of God because of what somebody else thinks, right? Now, if I just gloss over that, like, don't worry about what other people think. We're like, yeah. But that doesn't free us. Because it's so true that those close relationships, like our family of origin, maybe even people that aren't even alive anymore, and then authority figures sometimes can keep us bound to not be the people we want to be because we are living for their acceptance and thus dying from their rejection. And so David is facing this in both of those areas in this instance. Here's an example of how I am challenged with this sometimes. I love compliments. I don't love getting them. Right? Anybody else like that? Right? Where you have reason. Where, like, you love when you receive a compliment, but it's awkward when you're receiving the compliment. Right? You know, so somebody's telling me that the sermon I preached 2 years ago that they listened to online changed their life. That's so uncomfortable for me to hear that because I just want God to get the glory. I don't want it to be about me. Oh. However, it makes you feel good. It makes you feel good, right? And so, like, my flesh is out there sometimes sniffing. What did you say? Did you say something about the sermon today? Great teaching. She said, oh, come on. All the glory to God. It's not me, it's God. Now, I'm slightly sensitive, not that statistic. However, if I'm not going to be like we're going to see in David in a moment, I will rise or fall with other people's acceptance and accolades. Rise, I'll feel good when the sermon changed their life. And then when nobody says anything, I feel really bad about myself. Right? Or I'm really disappointed. This isn't to encourage you to all come up and talk to me afterwards. And then there are certain people who I'm really curious what they think. I really want to know what Joe Tessa thinks about the sermon. Because he's got a good sermon here. He listens to Louis Giglio and John Patrick. He listens to the best. So, you know, what did you say, Joe? You know, I like coming in. And so then when Joe doesn't say anything to me, when I talk to him after service, and he goes, hey, man, the food was really good today, wasn't it? I'm like, huh. Yeah, it was. And how about this? If Joe goes, hey, man, the sermon today, it was really interesting. Really interesting. I'm like, yeah, it's great. It's a key subject, quick. How's your kids? The food was good, wasn't it? And then I go find accolades from Lorraine because she feels that. Okay? And so what happens is, if I'm like this, I think about that. What did he mean interesting? Did he mean it was interesting because he was just studying that himself and it's really fueling some new things in him to grow in his relationship with God? Or did he mean interesting because it didn't make any sense and that's all he could say? What does that mean? I gotta make an appointment with Joe. I gotta meet with him Thursday because I'm thinking about it all day. Hey, bro, you said the sermon was interesting. What was interesting about it? I just stopped asking my wife. Right? And then the other thing I do is I try to find five people that liked it to counter Joe thinking it was interesting. Y'all got issues too, but I'm just out here right now. And so if I live for people's acceptance, I'll die from their rejection. Rather than, was I faithful to the Lord? Was I faithful to the Word? God, did I preach what you wanted, the way you wanted? And so if someone encourages me and it's blessing to them, praise God. And if everyone hates it, I don't care. And so we get closer to this place to see that friends, family, authority figures, or Joe Testa might be something that is going to challenge this pure motive of we're doing this because our expectation is in God. And so how is David free from that? How does he respond from that? Let's get there. The first piece with family, verse 29. How does he respond to his brother embarrassing him and mocking him and reminding him of his position and his failure? Verse 29, he says, what did I do? Wasn't I just asking a question? David is like, he doesn't have an over-the-top emotional response. He's like, hey, bro, what did I do wrong? He doesn't go, you always make me feel like I can't do anything. Tell him that. Nor did he respond by an inappropriate shutdown because of the resistance. What was I thinking? I'm just going to go. See, that's how some of us would have responded, either extreme, if family or friends or loved ones gave us resistance in our desire to go and serve God. And they didn't respond with, go for it, you can do it, here's 5 songs, go get it, David, right? Like Pam shared last week, you know, sometimes the people we're going to serve and love are going to have their lives change as a result of what you do. And sometimes they're going to give you so much resistance or no response at all. And we can't be fueled in our service and our lives for God by what other people respond. David is like, what's the problem? I just asked the question. He doesn't rise or fall because of his family or his brother. He's just silent. David didn't let his brother's fears and weaknesses and embarrassment stop him from serving God. He wasn't captive in his own choices by his brother's expectation or action. David wasn't swayed by his brother's acceptance nor his rejection. So what about the authority figure? What about Saul? Well, look at verse 33 again. Saul says, you can't do it. Well, what he does after that is he explains the lion and the bear thing. And here's the point on that. David responded when the authority was giving resistance by peacefully and truthfully explaining where his confidence and expectation came from. David wasn't nervous about what Saul's response might have been, right? He's standing before King Saul. King Saul flat out says, you can't do it, boy. You can't do it. You're a youth. You don't have what it takes. And David didn't go, is this okay with you? Maybe. He wasn't scrambling to prove his ability or his resume was equivalent to Goliath. He wasn't like, let me show you my skills, or I've been taking classes on military strategy, or I'm faster than my brother and I'm shorter than you. So he didn't do that. He didn't let Saul's authority intimidate or influence his call to serve God. He wasn't captive in his own choices because of Saul's doubt in him or the weakness in Saul's own heart. The reason why Saul and every one of the soldiers were behind in the battle line in fear was because they did not know the love and the power of the Lord, and their lack of knowing God is why they were held captive in fear. And this is where we will learn the foundational truth, which was true for David and fueled him to serve God unthwarted by any resistance, positive reinforcement, or whatever. You ready? Here's what it is. Here's what fueled David and pushed him to love and serve God no matter what. Are you ready? Verse 34. David said to Saul, his servant was tending his father's sheep when a lion or a bear came and took a lamb from the flock. I went out after him and I attacked him, rescued it from his mouth, and rose up. When he rose up against me, I seized him by his beard, struck him, and killed him. Your servant has killed both the lion and the bear. And this uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, since he has taunted the armies of the living God. And David said, the Lord who delivered me from the paw of the what? And the paw of the what? He will deliver me from the hand of the Philistine. David attributed his deliverance from the lion and the bear to God. And then he references that in his approach to Goliath. David was so sure of the love and presence of God because he had experientially known it through the victory of the lion and the bear. And so when Saul says no, and his brother says he says, well, this is what God's calling me to do. And I'm not worried about what you think. I'm not worried about whether you're thinking it's great or it's not so great, whether you think I can do it or I can't do it. God loves me. God is with me, and I can go and do what he's calling me to do. David had experienced the love of God on a personal level. And this empowered him to move forward, not fearful about the things before him. I mean, okay, look, we know this, the story of the lion and the bear. What happened with the lion and the bear? In your face, with no electric fence around the seat, no shotgun, no, you know, what, bear repellent or whatever. David out in the field by himself, and a lion and a bear come, and they try to take what's David's responsibility. You see, you know what it says in Amos? No, we don't. It says in Amos that when a lion or a bear attacks the sheep, that all that usually you can get back is like a leg or a thigh. David got the whole sheep back because God protected him and gave him what he needed to not just rescue the lamb, but to back down the lion and the bear and to defeat them. You know how David walked away from those encounters? He didn't walk away arrogant. He didn't walk away thinking, wow, God, a miracle happened. You're amazing. He walked away knowing God. He walked away knowing the love of God because God protected him and cared for him. And he experienced that. It wasn't just on Jesse's knee going, you know, God loves you. No, he experienced God's love through that victory. And so when he has resistance in what he thinks God is calling him to do, from his family, failures, from the opinion of his brother, from the authority figure in his life, you know what? That stuff did not sway him from his mission because he knew God's love and presence were with him. He knew God's love experientially. He knew that God loved him and cared for him. And so he even signed up to begin with because of that. What makes you so sure you can go face Goliath? God loves me. How do you know that? The lion and the bear. Why are you so confident, David, thinking that you can come here and even consider approaching this 9-foot-9 guy? What is it, David? God loves me. How do you know that? Because I've seen him show me his love through his hand on my life. David knew God loved him, so he wasn't afraid. He knew God loved him, so he wasn't held captive by his family. He knew God's love, so he wasn't thwarted by the resistance of those in authority. He knew God's love, so he wasn't afraid of Goliath. He knew the love of God. And this knowing was not just something on paper. Because nothing could convince David of a different opinion. You know, I grew up in a house where I was fortunate to know the Bible and to know about God and to know about Jesus. I was raised in a Christian home. My parents were wonderful and they did great. They taught me the Bible. But I didn't really care. I just knew how to play the part, nod at the right time, and sing in class with them, you know, complete, right? Do all the stuff we're supposed to do the right time and go through the motions. And I wore a real nice Christian costume, not just on Halloween, but all the time. But it wasn't real. And so I remember I'd hear teaching after teaching, like, God loves you, God loves you, good father. Right? We didn't have good father, but we had equivalent songs that talked about the love of God and his love for you and the love of Jesus. And I did not care. You know why? Because I had plenty of people who loved me already. It didn't mean anything to me. Everybody liked me. Everybody thought I was something special. Right? All the girls went, ooh, and all the guys went, ooh, I don't know, that's stupid. That didn't really happen. But I sure thought like it happened, right? And I had success in my life, and I achieved things in my life, and I was academically strong, I was athletically, you know, all right. But I had success in my life. And so you know what? saying God loved me wasn't that big a deal. It was just like, whatever. Okay, yeah, yeah. Is it time for the fool again? Or where's Jeff Bethesda? Until I went to college. And all of the validation in my life and all of the people who told me how special I was and wonderful I was were gone. And the people in college didn't care anything about me. I was filled with anxiety and panic. I didn't have people going ooh and ah. They didn't care. They didn't know me. They didn't want to know me. I had nothing. But suddenly, my life just crashed. My heart crushed. I would walk around Washington, D.C., filled with anxiety and fear. I was nervous that my roommates would see me eating by myself and come to me and say, oh, what are you doing? And I would have to make up a story that, like, I was still cool. But that's who I really was. All that other stuff was gone. It wasn't genuine and real. And so there I am in college, in my dorm room. The lights were down. I'm just struggling. I don't know which way to go. And I just got down on my knees and I said, God, and I knew I could go there. Though I don't remember the prayer I prayed, but I knew I could go there because the one thing I was sure of was that God loved me. But it wasn't until that moment that I really knew it to be. Because when all of the other stuff that I had longed for and wanted in my heart and wanted in my life were gone, all I was left with was me. And God pursued me. He responded to my cry. He showed me his love and set me on a path of change and transformation and mercy and grace that still continued but began in those moments. And I experienced for the first time the love of God. And so you know what? You can't talk me out of that. And so what my job is now as a Christian is to not forget that, but to live in that. Because if I live in that love, God's love for me that I experienced and that I know that was confirmed again and again and again and again, it still is being confirmed experientially, I will not hesitate to do whatever the Lord wants me to do. You know why? Because he loves me. It doesn't matter what's before me. See, the love of God, church, is such a big, huge foundation for us to rest our lives upon, that God loves you. And so no matter what your family says or doesn't say, no matter what I say or don't say, no matter what your boss and your parents say or don't say, you can stand because God loves you. And that's what David was presenting to the people that should have had influence over his heart had he not known the love of God is true. So what is David to do? Let's see what happens. Verse 41. Then the Philistine came on and approached David with the shield bearer in front of him. And when the Philistine looked and saw David, he disdained him, for he was but a youth and a ruddy with a handsome appearance. And the Philistine said to David, am I a dog that you come to me with sticks? And the Philistine cursed David by his God. And the Philistine also said to David, come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the sky and to the beasts of the field. And then David said to the Philistine, you come to me with a sword and a spear and a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have taunted. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I will strike you down and remove your head from you, and I will give the dead bodies of the army of the Philistines this day to the birds of the sky and the wild beasts of the earth, that all may know that there is a God in Israel. And all that this assembly may know, that the Lord does not deliver by sword or by spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands. And one of my most favorite verses in all Scripture, verse 48, then it happened when the Philistine rose and came to draw near to meet David, that David ran quickly toward the battle line to meet the Philistine. And David put his hand into his bag and took from it a stone and he slung it and he struck the Philistine on his forehead and the stone sank into his forehead so that he fell on his face to the ground. Thus David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone and he
struck the Philistine and he killed him, but there was no sword in David's hand. Then David ran and stood over the Philistine and took his sword and drew it out of the sheath and killed him and cut off his head with it. And when the Philistines saw that their champion was dead, they fled. The men of Israel and Judah arose and shouted and pursued the Philistines as far as the valley to the gates of Ekron. The slain Philistines lay along the way of Sarim, even to Gath and Ekron. The sons of Israel returned from chasing the Philistines to plunder their king. I think about that verse about David running so often because when I'm afraid of a situation or a person or a situation, I just think about David. He didn't just go, all right, I got to deal with this. He ran into that battle because he was so sure that God was with him and that God loved him and God was going to take care of him because he'd already experienced that with the lion and the bear. And David, his confidence is just so inspiring. And when you know God loves you, you can run. When you know God loves you, you can run into whatever God is calling you to go. How fast are you running? What's your pace? What's my pace? Is it backwards? Is it like, or is it running? Because if you know God's love for you, you can go no matter what resistance is going to come or how people are going to respond. But then that wasn't the end of the story. The end of the story is in verse 54. Then David took the Philistine's head, he's the part not tarnished or the fellowship. Then David took the Philistine's head and brought it to Jerusalem, but he put his weapons in his tent. So what was the last thing that David did? Right? He ran into the battle. God gave him victory. What fueled his ability to do what God wanted him to do, even though his family was giving him resistance and the authority figure wasn't supportive? What fueled him? God's love for him. How did he know God's love? He experienced God's love when the lion and the bear were defeated by David. And so we get off to this place now, and then what David does is he takes Goliath's head and he brings it into Jerusalem. He also brings Goliath's sword and shield. He puts the sword and the shield in his tent. What that tells me is that David knew that though the battle that day was over, there was going to be another battle. And just because he knew that God loves him so he could face that situation, it didn't mean he was done, one and done. Oh, I conquered what I was afraid of, and now I'm all set. No. He knew there'd be another battle. But you see, in the next battle that David was going to face, the next time David was going to serve God, he wasn't going to come there saying, I know God loves me because of the lion and the bear. He was going to say, I know God loves me because of the lion and the bear and because of Goliath. He built upon the victory that he had already had to be able to have confidence for the next one, and he knew there was another one. And so for us, right, I don't just rest on being a college kid knowing God's love. That would not fuel me the rest of the time. He's done it again. He's shown me his love again. And again, he's shown it to me again and again. And so it's not just my testimony in the past that I know God's love, but it's what he's done continue. I love these testimonies we share because it makes me go, yes, God is still at work. God is still alive. He's still in power. And it fuels me for the next thing we have to face because there might be resistance. And the other thing he did was he brought Goliath's head back. Yeah, that's so cool, right? Give me a yeah. I'm telling you, he walked into Jerusalem with that head. Somebody got delivered that day. He brought Goliath's head back to the place where everyone was afraid to go, look what God did. Look what God did. And the people that didn't fight in the battle, who were back at home afraid, saw what God did because David, knowing God's love, then went around and showed everybody what God had done. To David running towards Goliath without fear was his deep-rooted assurance of God's love for him. The key to David running past the opinions of his family or authority figure was that he knew God's love for him. So we ask this morning, what for us, what for me, is our lion and bear moment? That thing that we know loves us. And
sense, there's a different answer for each one of us, but here's what it is. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For while we were still helpless, Romans 5, 6, and 8, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. And God demonstrated his own love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. That is truer about me than what my family thinks about me. That is truer about me than what any authority figure is going to pressure me to not believe. This is the truest thing about me, that God loves me, that God is my Father, that Jesus Christ died for me, and that that's all I need to keep pushing through, to keep serving God, to not have my expectations on whether you think such and such was good or how people respond to the sandwich or whether the kids like the gifts we got them or whatever it is that we're going to do to serve God. Doesn't matter. You know why? Because God loves me. God loves me. And that is the thing that if we can experience the love of God, each one of you, I pray that we can experience the love of God. Experience the love of God so that we can be free from anybody else having sway over our soul. Because if God loves you, and you know it and experience God's love, that's all I need. So, our life's priority should be to bolster our love relationship with God, communion with him daily, and remembering what he has done. If you don't know God's love, and you want to just close your eyes right now, well, other people pray. Really, what prayer all it is just talking to God like you talk to a friend. You just use your regular English words. And maybe you want to ask him right now in this moment, God, I don't really know your love. I hear it. Okay, fine. I hear what he's saying. Full story. But I don't know it. I don't experience it. I know the catchphrase, but God, I'd like to experience your love. I'd like to know you, God. I'd like you to be my Father. If God answers that prayer for you that you pray right now, which he wants to, then what I've described of what life could be like won't just be far away or out of reach. So, Father, I pray right now with my family here that you would continue to help me know that you love me, that I would experience your love afresh today, that I would know your love. Lord, I want to be the kind of person that Pam talked about last week. Free to love, free to serve, free to give, free to speak truth. And so, Father, I pray that you would fill my heart with an awareness of your love, my life, God, that you would confirm your love for me and for us. Help me to be free from being captive to what other people think. Lord, I don't want to win the approval of others because I'm approved by you. I don't want to try to impress others because I believe I'm precious in your sight. And I don't want to live under the pressure of other people because I just want to be your child. And so if there's anyone here this morning that would like to know more about the love of God, I want to invite you to fill out one of our connection cards. There's a place you can check that you'd like to talk about following Jesus. And we'll talk about it, and we'll start this conversation. Because God loves you, and he wants you to know it right now.